I got into jazz probably, I started when I was 5, maybe when I was 8 years old. Because by that time I was very intrigued by the theory of guitar, you know, the way music works, how, you know, different compositional forms, and it's so natural to go right into jazz. And, you know, people like Jim Hall were big influences, Charlie Christian, Django Reinhardt, Matheny was an influence. And still a lot of the blues players, you know, Muddy Waters, T-Bone Walker, that all of that was kind of what I grew up with. There was a day where my brother and sister were going to visit family. So my dad had planned this very well. He said, okay, well, you know, why don't you go up in your room and hang out for a bit, because they have to go to the airport. And I went upstairs, and on my bed was this big box, kind of like a guitar. And like, it dawned on me, I was 5 years old, and I was like, this couldn't be, and it couldn't be. And I opened it, and it was, of course, a brand new Fender Stratocaster, beautiful. There was no second thoughts, just pick it up and play. So my dad had learned the Ray Charles song, What'd I Say? And he said, well, let me teach you this. It'll be the first thing, you know, at least you can play a song. And I spent the whole night playing the song over and over again for them, because we had no other entertainment. So it was kind of in my favor. I got to practice it over and over again. That's it. My first recording was when I was 11. I had met David Grisman, the mandolinist. So he did a record called Dog Duos, which was all duets, some with Vassar Clemens, Zakir Sain, Bela Fleck, everybody. So I got approached by different record labels and said, would you like to make a record? And quite honestly, I wasn't ready. I knew that when I made a record, it was gonna be not just a representation of my jazz background, my blues background, but that X factor, that other kind of music that I wasn't aware of yet, but I knew it was in me. So when that became clear to me, I started working with Ted Curlin. And when I felt ready, say, you know what? In the next year, I want my band to be out there. I want to share what I've been lucky to be a part of. It was a very natural journey coming to Emarcy as a label. You know, I grew up, again, because the jazz nerd that I am, listening to all the old Max Roach stuff and all the, like, I knew Emarcy really well. I had a bunch of that stuff. But we had to go to, you know, with any label or any situation, Ted was very great at representing me and saying, here's something that we think might offer something a little different than a jazz record, or a lot different, depending on how you look at it. These talks just happened over the course of a year or 2 years, and everything has been taken at a nice, even pace, all the way up to the recording of the album and then onward. From Columbia. I came to learn about him through New England Conservatory, and I saw him do a show once, and it was one of the greatest things I'd ever seen. He did a Jacob de Bandolim piece, a choro, that was extremely fast and intricate, and he just had this way of playing. He plays the cajon, and that was what he was playing at the time, so it's this box, and he was playing it just with so much dynamics, so much range. I kind of had that in the back of my mind. Okay, Tupac is really versatile, incredibly gifted, quite eccentric player, you know? What's interesting is Tupac was kind of the center of this, you know, this bicycle wheel, so to speak. He was there, and he was playing a lot with Ben Rosette, who was the saxophone player on this record. And so I'd seen them play together, so that was very important to see that they had a good connection. Now, Ben I met at Stanford Jazz Workshop when I was playing with Taylor for the very first time. I started teaching when I was 15. I think that was the year that Ben came just to hang out. So Ben came and he brought his friend Jorge Roeder, who was going to New England Conservatory. I said, that's amazing. Ben and Jorge have the best connection. And I love Jorge and I love Ben. These guys are like perfect. The cellist, Aristides Rivas, he's from Venezuela. And I would say also Jorge's from Peru. And Ben, though he's from Seattle, he worked at the UN in Colombia for a while. So again, everyone had, I knew they worked well together, and that's, you can't ask for anything better than that. I had some stuff together. I even had songs I had recorded with Gary Burton's band. One song, Clarity, was the last track on our CD, Next Generation. I always had the desire to kind of blow it up, expand it, do something different. And so the approach I took was inspired by Ben Rosette, who's on the record. And Ben's kind of, what he was trying to share with me was, the song's got a mood, it's got a sound. So why don't you just get used to living in that sound? You know, don't write the tune, just play with that in mind, play. And so I have like hours of recording of me just playing, thinking about that piece. From that, I would edit on my computer down fragments that I thought were especially interesting. And then I'd start all over again. Now play the interesting parts and add stuff. And you kind of whittle your way down to a form that suits the piece. Obviously, it's still the original Clarity, but we call it version 3.0 in a way, because it's gone through at least, you know, two major changes. And it features cello beautifully, which was kind of the reason to have it first on the record. Get the whole band up front. Bela Fleck when I was playing with Grisman a lot, so that was, I think I might have met him around the time I started getting more into acoustic music, playing a lot of acoustic guitar, and we used to have these great sessions. He would come to town, because he toured a lot in my area, and we would just play all day. He was so generous with his time. You know, I'm 12 years old, and he would spend, you know, 6 hours. He said, well, what are you working on? And I'd show him the jazz stuff. And I said, well, what are you doing? He'll show me tunes he's writing. So he had a big influence on just my willingness to kind of share music with other people, because he's such a good beacon of, like, bringing things together. You know, as you can hear in Fleck Tones and all his other records, I mean, he gets it. He knows how to do it. The other guest, who is Chris Thiele. Now, Chris Thiele is, you know, just incredible. I really have no words to say. He's unbelievable, and he's always been unbelievable. When I was young, growing up playing with David Grisman, I heard about him a lot when he was touring all over the world. And they would say, you got to hear this guy, Chris. You're very like-minded. I think you should meet. So what I did is I kind of followed Chris Thiele around, contacted him, got his phone number, left a message, drove long emails. Hi, my name's Julian. You don't know me, but you might know me because we were in the same area. And so we met. We met up and we played once in New York, and instant connection. I mean, what was funny is I brought him some of the music from the record. I brought him Little Darlin'. I said, well, what do you think about this? And he said, cool, cool, cool. And we played for, I don't know, 4 hours, and ended up writing a piece, or a beginning of a piece. We have the potential to include a lot of different kinds of music, so I'd love to see what, you know, the folks in Colombia think about, and if there's any drummers there we could play with. And I couldn't be more proud of the musicians involved and the team involved, that from here it's just about building on that momentum, you know, that creative momentum that's been building up for since I was five, and trying to not dilute it and just keep it opening and opening.